Ladies and gentlemen, this is the fourth week of our academic semester, not fourth week, but our fourth seminar, yes, fourth seminar of 4ST601. Today we will continue with a little bit more sophisticated methods, but only in descriptive way of contingency analysis. Analysis of contingency and the descriptive way of analysis of variance. We will finish, yes, we will finish with correlation coefficient. We will calculate the relationship, linear relationship between two samples. At this seminar, please don't ask me about the midterm tests. The most important information I said to you in the first seminar, in the first video recording, and other important information will be sent to you via email. So please wait for information in your school email addresses. Okay, we will start with first example. Analysis of dependence in descriptive way only. There is a table, yes. There were surveyed 93 patients suffering by a disease, whether they were vaccinated and what is the development of the disease. And there is a question, does the development of the disease depend on whether the patient was vaccinated? This is a sorted statistical table, yes, sorted table. We have here 93 persons, yes, 93 observations sorted to this table. We can say that we have here empirical frequencies, empirical values, empirical observations, yes, NEJ. So I will rewrite this table on the paper, and we will solve this on the paper. So empirical frequencies NEJ, yes, patient vaccinated, yes, no, yes, and development of the disease mild and hard. So this is a table. We can say a contingency table, yes, with frequencies, with absolute frequencies. So 33, 9, 15, and 36. And there was said that we have sample size, yes, the size of this sample is equal to 93, yes. So in this table we have absolute frequencies, NEJ, empirical frequencies, and for the calculation of the strength of the dependence, you know that it's necessary to calculate statistic G, the value of G, yes? So we will use formulas and we will see what is necessary to have to calculate for this statistic G, G value. You know that in this table we are able to calculate marginal frequencies N E dot and N dot J, yes, marginal frequencies or side frequencies, frequencies calculated on the side, yes, on the sides of this table. What is it? Marginal frequency. It's a summation of frequencies in rows and summation of frequencies in columns. Yeah? So it's very easy. 33 plus 9 is 42, yes, and 36 plus 15, 46, 50, 51, yes, 51. And you can see, if you calculate summation 42 plus 51, you have the sample size here, 93 patients suffering by a disease, yes? And the same here, summation of values in columns, yes? N dot J, 33 plus 15 is 48, yes? 48 is here. And 36 plus 9 is 45. And if you calculate 48 plus 45, result should be 93 patients, yes? So we have here marginal frequencies, frequencies calculated on the sides, yes? We know that for the calculation of this G value, it's necessary to transform this empirical table with empirical, empirical frequencies, yes, this table with empirical frequencies, it's necessary to recalculate to another table with frequencies N, E, J with stripe, expected frequencies or theoretical frequencies, yes? I can write here the word expected. Expected or theoretical, yes? Theoretical frequencies, N, E, J with stripe, yes? You can check your formulas, yes? And you can find the formula for calculation N, E, J with stripe in a nominator, N, E dot times N dot J, yes, divided by N. Yes, so now you can calculate, you can recalculate this table to theoretical expected table, table with expected values. So there is mild, there is hard, yes, patient vaccinated, yes, no. So this is the same table, yes, and you must calculate four new values, yes, four new values. So you can see these marginal frequencies, yes. So you can see there is first position, second position, third position and fourth position, yes? And how can you calculate these values? Using side frequencies. So 42 times 48 divided by 93. This will be result for the first position, yes? And we can continue another side marginal frequencies, yes? Second value, 42 and 45. So 42 times 45 divided by 93, yes? And you can continue third position. So 48 and 51, yes? So 48, or I can use this for 51. It doesn't matter, yes? Because there is multiplication, so it's not necessary to use the order, yes? 51 and 48. 48 divided by 93, yes, and last value 51 and 45. 51 times 45 divided by 93. Yes? And now you need to use calculator and calculate these expected theoretical values. Yes? So I have here calculator. And first position, 42 times 48 divided by 93. 21.68. Yes? And we can continue. 42 times 45 divided by 93. 20.32. 20.32. 51. And 48, 51 times 48 divided by 93, 26.32, and finally 51 times 45 divided by 93, 24.68. Okay, so you have here calculated theoretical expected frequencies. Yes, there we have empirical data and there we have expected frequencies, expected data. In statistic G, yes, if you check your formulas, in statistic G, is written that this is calculated like summation through all rows and summation through all columns. Yes, this table, yes, has two rows and two columns. Two rows, two columns, yes. And there we have summation through all rows and all columns. And what is here? NEJ minus NEJ with stripe in squares, yes, divided by NEJ with stripe. I will use different color because it will be better for you. So there we have values of empirical frequencies. There we have calculated expected theoretical frequencies, yes? And now I will use this formula, yes? So for partial values, so in parentheses, 33 minus 21.68. It must be in squares divided by 21.68, yes? And you can continue plus another difference. 9 minus 20.32 in squares divided by 20.32. And you can continue plus 15 and 26.32, so 15 minus 26.32 in squares divided by 26.32 plus, and finally 36 minus 24.68 in squares divided by 24.68, yes? You can see it's not difficult, but we must be precious, yes? It spent a lot of time and we must be precious. So, I will use calculator for partial values. So, please wait a second. 33 minus 21.68 in squares divided by 21.68, 5.91 plus, and you can continue, 9 minus 20.32 in squares divided by 20.32, 6.31, 6.31 plus. And we can continue. 15 minus 26.32 squared divided by 26.32. 4.87 plus, and finally 36 minus 24.68 squared divided by 24.68 5.19. Okay, and now these four values, 5.91 plus 6.31 plus 4.87 plus 5.19, 22.28. So this is value of G. So, there is our table, yes? Table with empirical frequencies, development of the disease, yes? Mild heart, patient was vaccinated, yes or no? There we have table with expected frequencies, yes? And according to this formula, we used empirical and theoretical frequencies, and we calculated value of G, value of this statistic G, and this statistic G is used in two important formulas. If you check your formulas, you can find here Pearson coefficient of contingency. Pearson coefficient of contingency C and Kramer coefficient of contingency V. Okay. Pearson C, yes, and Kramer V. Pearson coefficient contingency C is calculated like square root, and there we have G in numerator divided by G plus N. Yes, in our situation, can see there is our G value 22.28. So this is square root 22.28 divided by 22.28 plus sample size. How many patients we have? We have 93 patients, yes? 93. Okay, Kramer coefficient of contingency V is calculated again like square root, and there is G divided by N times M minus 1, yes? We must calculate what is M. M is minimum, yes? Minimum from rows and columns, yes? We have two rows and two columns, yes? Two rows, two columns. What is smaller? What is minimum? It doesn't matter, yes? 2. So M is 2. Statistic G, you know that statistic G, 22.28, yes? Divided by sample size, number of patients, yes? 93 patients times, and the smaller value from 2 or 2, yes? 2 minus 1. Okay, so now we can calculate the value of C and the value of V, yes? 22.28 divided by 22.28 plus 93, enter, square root from this value, enter, is 0.4396. 4396. Yes? So this is Pearson coefficient of contingency. And now Kramer, 22.28 divided by 93, because 2 minus 1 is 1, 93 times 1 is 93, yes? So divided by 93, square root from this value is 0.4895, yes? So we have here two values, yes? Two important values. And now, how can we interpret the result, yes? It's necessary to know that Kramer coefficient V, yes? Kramer coefficient V is element of range 0 and 1, yes? If this coefficient is close to 1, yes, there is strong dependence between variable 1 and variable 2, yes? We have two variables in our table, yes? Development of the disease and vaccination. Yes, and you can see we are almost in the middle, yes? There is almost 50%, yes? Almost 50% of dependence. We are almost in the middle. So it's easy to imagine the strength of the dependence, yes? Mr. Hellman said to you that it's interpretation, verbal interpretation, is very subjective, yes, to say the response, middle strength dependence, yes, I don't know, but we know that this coefficient is element of range 0 and 1, so you can imagine, yes, you can imagine the strength of the dependence, but Pearson coefficient, yes, Pearson coefficient C value, yes, is element of range, yes, of course, there is zero, and we must calculate the maximum, yes, square root, and there is m minus 1 divided by m, yes, and again, m is minimum from rows and columns, yes, minimum from rows and columns, so this is potential maximum, square root 2 minus 1 divided by 2, yes? And I will calculate this potential maximum, yes? 2 minus 1 is 1 divided by 2 and square root from this value 0.707, yes? So we know that there is zero, yes, and there is potential maximum 0.707. And our C value, Pearson coefficient C, yes, is here 0.4396, yes? It's a little bit more complicated to imagine the strength of the dependence, yes? Because maximum is not 1, yes? Maximum must be calculated. Okay, we will continue. In a lot of countries around the world, it's prohibited to drink alcohol before you drive, yes? So we can expect that there is relation or dependence between the level of alcohol in blood and the speed of the reaction in car. Yeah? So there is another example. We have here a sorted table, yes, the data set sorted to contingency table with empirical observed, yes, observed frequencies. There was observed the relation between the level of alcohol in blood, low, middle, and high, and the speed of the reaction in car, yes, good or bad, by 100 randomly selected people. So we have here sample size 100 people, 100 drivers, yes, and we would like to calculate some coefficient, yes, some coefficient which can illustrate the strength of this dependence. Yes, you can see that this table is larger than the previous one. We have here 3 rows and 2 columns. Yes, so I will use the paper. I will rewrite the data set, empirical frequencies N E J. Yes, speed of the reaction good and bad. Yes, and level of alcohol low, middle, and high. Yes, and 100 randomly selected drivers. So this is sorted statistical table, contingency table with empirical values. Yes, so we have here 53, 12, 5, 15, 2, and 13. Yes, so this is our table. And for the calculation of the strength of the dependence, you already know that you need to calculate two coefficients. Yes, we have two coefficients, Pearson statistic C, C value, and Kramer coefficient V. Yes, for the calculation of Pearson C and Kramer V, you need to calculate statistic G value. Yes, because there is square root G divided by sample size 100 drivers plus statistic G, yes, and Kramer V is calculated like G divided by N times M minus 1, yes. Okay, so how can we calculate statistic G? We need to transform this table. Yes, this table must be recalculated to another table N E J with stripe. Yes, good reaction, bad reaction, low level, middle, and high. Yes, and we must use marginal frequencies. Yes, marginal frequencies from original table. So this is table with expected frequencies. Yes, I will write here expected. Yes, expected or theoretical. Yes, or theoretical. Expected or theoretical frequencies, and here we have empirical frequencies. Okay, so side frequencies or marginal frequencies, as you like it, yes, N E dot, and here N dot J, yes, what is it? Marginal frequency, side frequency. Frequencies calculated on the side, yes, on the side of this table, summation. Summation of rows, summation of columns, yes, 53 plus 10 is 63, plus 2 is 65. 65 is here, yes? 5 and 15, 20. 2 and 13, 15, yes? If you calculate a summation of these marginal frequencies, 65 and 20, 70, 85, and 5 is 90, and 10 is 100 drivers, 100 drinking drivers, yes? And here, 53 and 5 is 58, and 2 is 60. And there must be 40, yes? If there will not be 40, I have a fault somewhere. 12, 15 and 13 must be 40, because 60 plus 40 is equal to 100, yes? So you have here empirical frequencies with marginal frequencies, yes? Marginal frequencies calculated here on the sides, yes? And we will recalculate this table using this formula, NEJ with stripe is equal to NE dot times, yes? This is dot, this is not times. Times N dot J divided by N, yes? 65 times 60 divided by 100 drivers, yes? And we can continue. 65 times 40 divided by 100 drivers, yes? And you can continue. 20 and 60. 20 times 60 divided by 100 drivers. 20 and 40. 20 times 40 divided by 100 drivers. And finally, 15 and 60. 15 times 60 divided by 100 drivers. And 15 times 40 divided by 100 drivers, yes? So you have here 6 partial results, and now I will use calculator and I will calculate these expected frequencies NEJ with stripe. So 65 times 60 divided by 100, 39, yes, 39 persons. We can continue. 65 times 40 divided by 100, 26 drivers, yes. Okay, 20 times 60 divided by 100, 12 drivers, 20 times 40 divided by 100, 8 drivers, 15 times 60 divided by 100, 9 drivers, and finally 15 and 40, 15 times 40 divided by 106 drivers, yes? So you have here two tables, yes? This empirical table and this independent table. How the situation looks like, yes? If there will be everything independent, yes? Level of alcohol in blood and the speed of the reaction. So, now we know that we need to calculate G value, yes? So I will use another paper, and in your formulas you have written that G is calculated like summation through all rows, summation through all columns, yes? And there is numerator, NEJ, minus NEJ with stripe, yes? This must be in squares, and this is divided by NEJ. Okay, so 6 partial results, 6 partial values, yes. If you check this table, you need this one, and here this one. Yes. Okay, so these values. So I will rewrite the partial values here. So 53 minus 39. Yes, this must be in squares, divided by 39, plus 12 minus 26, squared, divided by 26, plus, you can see, 5 and 12, yes? You can continue. 5 minus 12 squared divided by 12 plus 15 minus 8 squared divided by 8 plus 2 minus 9 squared divided by 9 plus, and finally 13 and 6, yes, you can see 13 minus 6 squared divided by 6. Okay, so I will calculate these partial results. So 53 minus 39 squared divided by 39, 5.03 plus 12 minus 26 squared divided by 26, 7.54 plus 5 minus 12 squared divided by 12, 4.08 plus 15 minus 8 squared divided by 8, 6.13 plus 2 minus 9 squared divided by 9, 5.44. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, last one, yes, 13 minus 6 squared divided by 6, 8.17, okay, and now, statistic G, value of G is equal to 5.03 plus 7.54 plus 4.08 plus 6.13 plus 5.44 plus 8.17, 36.39. Okay, 36.39. This is value of statistic G. Yes, and now we will use this value, yes, we will use this value for calculation of Pearson coefficient contingency C and Kramer coefficient of contingency V. So C value is equal to, that is, square root nominator, G value, G statistic, 36.39 divided by, N is sample size, 100 drivers, plus 36.39, yes? So this is G value, and Cramer V, Cramer coefficient V, square root, g-statistic, 36.39, divided by sample size, 100 times, M, what is M in your formulas? Minimum from rows and columns. What is smaller, 3 or 2? You have 3 rows, 2 columns. 2 is smaller, yes? So M is minimum from rows and columns, 2 minus 1, yes? In your formulas. Okay, so we will calculate C value and V value. So 36.39 divided by 136.39. Square root from this value is 0.5165. Yes. Okay, and now Cramer V. 36.39 divided by 100 only, yes? 100. Square root from this value 0.6032. According to my subjective opinion, I think that Cramer V is a little bit better because we know that this coefficient is element of range from 0 to 1, yes? And it's possible to interpret, for example, in percent, 60.32%, but we know that it's not a percentage, but the strength of the dependence, yes? 0, no dependence, yes? 1, perfect dependence, yes? So you are able to imagine, yes, the strength between the level of alcohol in blood, yes, and the speed of the reaction in car, yes? So it's dependent, yes? There is dependence, and the verbal classification, verbal answer is subjective, yes? Mr. Hellman said that it's very subjective if you say that there is middle strength dependence, yes? I don't know, but we know that this value is between 0 and 1, so we know where this value is placed. Pearson C, yes, needs to calculate maximum. We know that maximum of C value in this situation is 0 is minimum and maximum is square root, and there is in parentheses M minus 1 divided by M. Yes. So we know that there is 0 and maximum square root. M is minimum from rows and columns, yes? So what is smaller, 3 or 2? 2. 2 minus 1 divided by 2, yes? So again, this is the same result like before. 1 divided by 2, 1 divided by 2, and square root from this result, 0.7071, yes? So this is potential maximum of this coefficient, yes? And we know that our C value, so there is 0, there is this maximum, and our C value is equal to 0.5165, yes? So again, you know minimum and maximum, and you know where is placed our coefficient. We will continue with another method for the calculation of existing dependence. We observed 12 students, how many points they got from the final test. So we have here values, yes, from 0 to 60. Four from these students were always attended the classes of one of three teachers, Mr. McDonald, Mr. King, and Mr. Benz. And that is the question, has the person of the teacher the influence on the number of achieved points from the final test? So we will try to calculate some coefficient, representing influence of the teacher, yes, on the number of achieved points. So it will be good to rewrite this table to columns, yes, on the paper. Okay, so we will use observations X, E, J. Yes, X, E, J, and the values. Yes, we have here Mr. McDonald, King, and Benz. Yes, so this one will be Mr. McDonald. Yes, and values here 53, 47, 55, 50. Yeah? So this is group of Mr. McDonald, Mr. King. Yes, Mr. King, and his values 42, 48, 48. And 50, yes, okay, and the last group of Mr. Benz, so Donald, King, and Benz, okay, 39, 46, 39, and 43, yes. Okay, so we have here the data set. What we need to calculate? We would like to interpret some effect size, yes? Potential existing dependence. In your formulas, you can find section analysis of variance, ANOVA. Yes, this is the shortcut. Analysis of variance, and for the calculation of effect size, yes, for calculation of effect size, you need to know sum of squares treatment, or in another literature called, for example, theoretical or treatment sum of squares, yes, divided by sum of squares total. Yeah, so treatment or theoretical sum of squares divided by total sum of squares. Yes. So we need to know that treatment sum of squares, yes, STR, treatment sum of squares, is calculated like summation through all J, yes, and there is a squared difference, yes, squared difference between X, J with stripe, so individual mean calculated for the particular teacher, minus total mean calculated on the base of our all data set, and this is weighted times NJ. Yes, this is weighted by number of students. So this is treatment sum of squares. You can find this formula in your formula sheet. And total sum of squares, yes, is calculated like summation through all E, summation through all J. And again, there must be some squared differences between X, E, J and X with stripe total mean. Okay, so what we need to calculate? We need to calculate the total mean, yes? Total mean X with stripe. Total mean will be calculated from 12 values, yes? So there we have 12 values. There is my calculator, and now I will calculate 53 plus 47 plus 55 plus 50 plus 42 plus 48 plus 48 plus 50 plus 39 plus 46 plus 39 plus 43. Enter. 560 divided by 12, yes? 560 divided by 12, and there is the total mean, which is equal to 46.67, yes? This is the total mean. Okay, what we need to calculate XJ with stripe. So, three individual means for the particular teacher, yes? So, there is Mr. McDonald, yes? X, J with stripe, yes? Individual means for the particular teacher. So, summation, yes? Summation of four values divided by four. So, again, I will use the calculator. 53 plus 47 plus 55 plus 50, yes, 205 divided by 4, and result divided by 4, 51.25, yes. So this is the first individual mean, yes, for Mr. McDonald. And we can continue another mean. 42 plus 48 plus 48 plus 50. 188 divided by 4. Yes, divided by 4. 47. So this is individual mean for Mr. King. And individual mean for Mr. Benz will be here, 39 plus 46 plus 39 plus 43 divided by 4. So this is 167 divided by 4, and the result is 41.75, yes? So you have here three means, yes? So now it's easy because we can calculate treatment sum of squares, yes? Treatment sum of squares STR, yes? And this treatment sum of square is calculated summation through all J, and there we have X, J with stripe minus total mean squared weighted by N, J. Everything we have, yes? Because there is this mean, 51.25 minus total mean, this mean, 46.67 squared, weighted by 4 students, yes? Weighted by 4 students, okay. And you can continue here. 47 minus 46.67 squared, weighted by 4 students, And finally, 41.75 minus 46.67 squared, weighted by 4 students. So, 3 partial results. Yes, I will use calculator. 51.25 minus 46.67 squared times 4. 83.91. Forty-seven minus 46.67 squared times 4, 0.44. And here, 41.75 minus 46.67 squared times 4. 96.83. Okay, and summation of these three values, yes, 83.91 plus 0.44 plus 96.83, summation of these values is STR treatment sum of squares 181.18 treatment sum of squares, yes. A little bit complicated is to calculate total sum of squares, yes. Total sum of squares, because we need to use all values and the total mean, yes. So it will be a little bit complicated, yes. Can you see here on the left side values, yes. So I will write it here. I must calculate square differences x, e, j minus total mean in squares, yes. So these values minus this mean in squares, yes. So there will be 53 minus 46.67 squared, yes. And you can continue. 47 minus 46.67 squared, yes. 55 minus 46.67 squared. 50 minus 46.67 squared, yes. And you can continue. Another group, yes, another teacher, Mr. King. 42 minus 46.67 squared. 48 minus 46.67 squared, etc., etc. 48 minus 46.67 squared, and 50 minus 46.67 squared, yes. The mean is still the same, because you can see here the total, yes, sum of squares is calculated on the basis of this total mean, yes. And last four values, 39 minus 46.67 squared, 46 minus 46.67 squared, and 39 minus 46.67 squared. Last value, 43 minus 46.67 squared, yes? Okay, so 12 values, 12 squared differences. I will use only 2 decimals, yes? For simplification, 46.67 squared. So there we have 40.07. 40.07. 47 minus 46.67 squared. 0.11. 0.11. 55 minus 46.67 squared. 69.39. 69.39. 50 minus 46.67 squared. 11.09. Okay, so this is Mr. McDonald. Yes, Mr. McDonald is ready. 42 minus 46.67 squared. 21.81. 21.81. 48 minus 46.67 squared. 1.77. 1.77. There will be again 1.77. And I already calculated 50. There is 11.09. Yes? 39. 39 minus 46.67 squared. 58.83. Yes? 46 minus 46.67 squared, 39, I already calculated 39, 58.83, and 43 minus 46.67 squared. 13.47. So summation will be total sum of squares. Yes. So I will calculate the summation. Yes. The sum of all these values. 40.07 plus 0.11 plus 69.39 plus 11.09 plus 21.81 plus 1.77 plus 1.77 plus 11.09 plus 58.83 plus 0.45 plus 58.83 plus 13.47. 288.68. Okay, so you have total sum of squares and treatment sum of squares. Yes, so we can calculate this effect size. I don't know where. Yes, maybe here. Effect size is calculated like ratio treatment sum of squares 181.18 divided by 288.68. Yes, it's not difficult. Yes, it's not difficult, but you can see that there's a lot of steps. Yes, a lot of steps. But it's simple, just some differences, second powers. Yes, and ratios, nothing more. So 181.18 divided by 288.68. Yes, 0.6276. So this is effect size. Yes. This is effect size. And now, what was the question? So we observed, yes, we observed 12 students, how many points they got from the final test. And has the person of the teacher the influence on the number of achieved points from the final test? We know that this effect size, yes, this effect size, effect size is element of range from 0 to 1, yes, and our effect size 0.6276, 0.6276, yes, is inside this interval, so you can see the strength of the dependence, yes. There is 0, there is 1, no dependence of the person of the teacher, perfect dependence, yes, influence of the person of the teacher, and there is your result, 0.6276. So, Mr. Hellman said to you that it's very subjective, yes, to verbal evaluate this value, but you know that minimum is 0, maximum is 1, and this is the strength. We will continue. There is an experiment, yes, using experiment. There was tested consumption using 3 types of petrol. There were done 5 experiments with each petrol. Fill in the ANOVA table and try to decide in descriptive way whether the consumption depends on the type of petrol. It means measure the tightness of potential dependence. So we don't have here data set, yes? In the previous example, we had students and teachers, yes? And now we know that we analyzed 3 types of petrol. For example, OM, FAO, Shell, and AGIP, yes? So we have here 3 types of petrol, yes? So 3 types of petrol, and there is written that there were done 5 experiments with each petrol. So according to previous situation, previous example, values X, E, J, yes, observations. We don't have observations, yes. You can imagine only that there we have O, M, V, yes, and observation X, 1, X, 2, X, 3, X, 4, and X, 5, yes. We have shell, yes, and again observation X1 until X5, and finally we have AGIP, yes, finally we have AGIP, and again observation X1 until X5, yes, but we don't have this data set, yes, we don't have this data set. So 3 types of petrol, 5 experiments with each of them. So 3 times 5 is equal to 15 observations. 15 observations in total. So 15 is our N sample size, yes? And there is calculated ANOVA table, yes? I will show you later, yes, how this example can be solved in Excel or ANOVA. How can ANOVA be solved in Excel, yes? Now we have only output. What is written here? This table has names, yes, in the first row and 3 other rows, yes? The source can be also called source of variability, yes, source of variability, and we have here between groups source of variability, and within group source of variability, yes, in some software, yes, can be called this first row model, model source of variability, and the second one error source of variability. In a previous example, with students and teachers, Mr. McDonald, King, and Benz, yes, we wanted to calculate effect size, yes, effect size, like a ratio, sum of squares treatment, sum of squares, and sum of squares total, yes, total sum of squares. So it will be good to show you different words, yes, for treatment, yes, because you can see here that in software, yes, treatment can be called between group, yes, between group. This can be called as well like model, yes, model, and for example theoretical, yes, theoretical. So we can say that there we have treatment sum of squares, between group sum of squares, model sum of squares, theoretical sum of squares, explained, yes, explained sum of squares, and maybe regression sum of squares, yes. Regression sum of squares, yes. All these words, all these words you can call synonyms, yes, the words with similar meanings. Treatment, between group, model, theoretical, explained, regression, yes. So this is in numerator. In denominator, we have total, yes? Okay. What else is here? Within group error. What is this? Again, I will write here for you synonyms, the words with similar meaning, yes? For within group. Within group, yes, there can be written error, source of variability, yes, error, source of variability, for example, residual, yes, residual source of variability. Can you see this explained? So there can be written unexplained. Yes, unexplained. This is all, I think, yes. So source of variability. First row, second row, and third row, yeah? So remember this table, and please remember all of these synonyms, yes? Which you can find here, because we will not use Excel only. Maybe in the future you will see different table, yes? And you need to know, yes, these synonyms, because every software use different words. Okay, so there you can find sum of squares, yes, and we know that total, yes, total sum of squares is calculated like sum of squares treatment plus sum of squares error. Yes, treatment and error sum of squares. So in our situation, model sum of squares, yes, which is not calculated here, but we are able to calculate this model or treatment sum of squares. Sum of squares TR, like treatment, is equal to sum of squares total minus sum of squares error. In our situation 0.025077 3 minus 0.08 0280. Yes. Okay, you can use calculator 0.250773 minus 0.080280. Enter. So treatment sum of squares is 0.170493. Yes. Okay. We can write this here to this table. Yes. So I can write here 0.170493. Okay, you can see that this will continue in the future. Yes, degrees of freedom. You will learn about degrees of freedom in the future. Mean square, the variance. Yes, mean calculated from squares. Yes, sum of squares divided by degrees of freedom. You will learn this in the future, week 11. And Fisher F statistic. Again, you will see this in the future. Now, it's enough for us, sum of squares, and the knowledge about this source of variability. So, for the calculation of effect size, yes, you need to know treatment and total sum of squares. So treatment sum of squares 0.170493 divided by total sum of squares 0.250773. Okay. So 0.170493 divided by 0.250773. Enter. 0.6799. Okay, so this is effect size, and we know that this effect size is element of range from 0 to 1. Yes, so it's possible to interpret this in percent, almost 68%. Yes, is the strength of the dependence. So probably it depends. Yes, the consumption depends on the type of petrol. Okay, last example for today. At 15 boys at the elementary school, there was measured how many of push-ups and squats they are able to do. Calculate whether there is mutual linear dependence between the number of push-ups and number of squats by appropriate coefficient of dependence. So you have here data set. Yes, you have here data set with 15 boys. Yes, and there we have two variables. Yes, the first variable, number of squats. The second variable, number of push-ups. Yes, we can denote squats like X and push-ups like variable Y. Yes, X and Y. And we would like to calculate by appropriate coefficient of dependence something, yes, which is able to explain this potential dependence, yes? We can expect that if the boy is strong, he is able to do a lot of squats and a lot of push-ups, yes? If the boy is weak, for example, this one, yes, he is probably loser because he is not able to do any squat and any push-up, yes? So we can expect, yes, we can expect that there is linear dependence between the number of squats and number of push-ups. So in your formulas, you will find this one, this formula, R X Y, yes? Correlation coefficient. Correlation coefficient. What we need for calculation of correlation coefficient? In nominator, yes, there is xy mean minus x mean times y mean, yes. So we need to calculate multiplication between first and second variable and calculate the mean, yes. The mean from variable x and the mean from variable y, yes? And in denominator, there is square root, yes? And here we have x squared mean minus x mean squared times, and there is the same with second variable, variable y. So y squared mean minus y mean squared, yes? So everything what we need, yes, is 5 means, yes? Okay, so I will move this, yes, and here on the top of this paper I need to calculate x, y multiplication. I need to calculate x in squares, and I need to calculate y in squares, yes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 means, and that's all, yes? So, can you see what I will calculate? 1 times 10 is 10, yes? 3 times 15, 45, yes? 2 times 15, 30, 0, 5 times 40, 5 times 40, 200, yes, 6 times 25, 150, 1 times 7 is 7, 4 times 31 is 124, 3 times 30 is 90, 5 times 35 is 175, 6 times 41 is 246, 2 times 10 is 20, 1 times 14 is 14, 1 times 9 is 9, and 8 times 64 is 512, yes? So there is one new column, x squared, yes? 3 squared, 9, 4, 0, 25, 36, 1, 4 times 4 is 16, sorry, 16, 9, 25, 6 squared, 36, 4, 1, 1, and 8 squared, 64, yes, 64, okay? and the second power of this variable. Yeah, so 10 squared 100, 15 squared 225, 225, 0, 40 squared 1600, 25 squared 625, 7 squared 49, 31 squared 961, 30 squared 900, 35 squared 1225, 41 squared 1681, 114 squared 196, 9 squared 81, and 64 squared 4096. Okay, I calculated these means for you, yes? It spent a lot of time, but you can use Excel, yes? You can train at home, yes? And you can calculate these five means in Microsoft Excel, yes? Because you can use function equal sign average. Yes, equal sign average, you will open parenthesis, yes, you will select 15 values, you will close the parenthesis and you will press enter, yes, and you should see these values. So you can see it's not difficult, but you need to do a lot of steps. So now I will solve this correlation coefficient. So this mean 108.8 minus 3.2 times the mean from y variable push-ups 23.07. This is divided by square root, and there is the mean from second power, yes, of a variable x. So in parentheses, 15.47 minus 3.2 squared, yes, times, and there is the mean calculated from variable y, second power of variable y. So 804.27 minus second power of mean of variable y, 23.07 second power, yes. Okay, so equal sign. Okay, so I will start with the denominator. So in parentheses, 15.47 minus 3.2 squared, close parentheses, times, open parentheses, 804.27 minus 23.07 squared, close parenthesis, enter, square root from this result, enter, and now numerator 108.8 minus 3.2 times 23.07, close parenthesis, divided by denominator, enter. And result are between x and y correlation coefficient is equal to 0.9273. This is correlation coefficient, yes? We know that correlation coefficient is statistic again from range minus 1, from range minus 1 plus 1. Yes, I will write it better here, minus 1 plus 1. Yes, if this correlation coefficient is close to minus 1, yes, there is strong negative linear dependence between variable x and variable y. If this correlation coefficient is close to plus 1, this is our case, yes, there is strong linear positive dependence between variable x and variable y. Yes, as I said, if the boy is strong, he is able to do a lot of squats and a lot of push-ups. Yes, if the boy is weak, yes, he is not able to do a lot of squats and a lot of push-ups. So there is strong positive linear dependence. If the coefficient will be close to zero, variables x and y are independent, linearly independent, yes? But this is not our case. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, so this is the end of our fourth seminar. Next week we will continue, yes? We will continue mainly with methods which you can find in fourth and fifth presentation, yes, given by Mr. Hellman. And as I said at the beginning of this seminar, wait on information about the first midterm test, yes? That's all for today. Mainly study statistics and be prepared for everything. So that's all from me. Thank you for your attention. Have a nice day and bye bye. I hope that I will see you next week on the fifth seminar of 4ST601.